So, I think we are live at the moment. I hope I timed my introduction correctly. So, I planned for today. I looked up a study that is publicly available, and I prepared it a little bit. So I read it for like 5 minutes. And there are so already some issues with the study, but we will dive into it. Oh, it's my original Zettelkasten. So let's switch the archive. So please be more responsive. Ah, thanks, Christian. So please open the other archive. Oh, Christian performed an update. Today, it's already open. So, yes. Hello. Can you say Kraftfahrzeughaftpflichtversicherung? Very easy. If you want to have some real German tongue breakers, you need to challenge me even more. Kraftfahrzeughaftpflichtversicherung ist, to be honest, very easy for a German to pronounce. So, let's see, is it zoomed? Yes, but I let it zoomed. I think it's better for the YouTube video. So, this is a study on overtraining. And you see here that it's a study on the phenomenon. So, for the people who are not very familiar with this stuff, overtraining basically means you are feeling kind of depressed. And it is normally thought that it comes from excessive training. So, the name is overtraining syndrome. But the authors here suggest that it's not about training too much, but about a different thing, and you will find a strange thing. I don't know where I can find it. Mixed results here. Overtraining occurred independent from excessive training. That is kind of interesting. So, how do we prepare the Zettelkasten? Let's see. Movement. No. Not movement, but perhaps sports. No. Training. Okay, I'm teasing a bit. We never worked on training. So, how do we call our structure node? I think it's first level. So, I will just replicate from my own Zettelkasten movement and mobility. No, this is actually strange. In German, I have two concepts, Bewegung und Mobilität. So, it's in direct translation would be movement and mobility, but the concept or the term movement is used in a different way in English, I think. So perhaps I go with just movement. In Germany, I have, or in Germany, in German, I have, something that I call the six categories of I can just make it here. So I have 6 categories of health and fitness. Basic model categories of health, robustness, fitness. So we start with this. Health, robustness, fitness. So the categories are movement, mobility. So let's call it not fitness, but not and not movement, but perhaps performance. Let's go with movement and we change it later. So movement, mobility. Okay, the issue is, so we go with 3 and mental. No, cognitive health. So I think in English, 3 concepts are more appropriate. So there are 2 types each: anabolic and catabolic. Anabolic mobility, mobilization, catabolic working out. Anabolic eating, catabolic fasting, and cognitive anabolic quietness, catabolic thinking, cognition. So we go with so let me s- oh wrong 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 ah okay perhaps I beated you. Okay, let's go into movement, and this will be and this will be overtraining. Overtraining. Concept. Oh, I need to have the BibTeX. Oh, thank you. I prepared it, Cadigiani. Where is it, you kaka? Kata? Ah. So, concept. So, the overall study design is they observed athletes. Lenny! Lenny! Stop! I'm sorry, I need to shout at my dog because she's a bit stubborn. I hate shouting. Another bark. So they basically what they did is, I think, present here. Please give me the thing. So behaviors, unchanged marker overtraining. Okay, this is not the sorting mechanism. Where is it? So, okay, just we have it here. So I read it out loud. We compared the types and proportions of behavioral pattern of 67 evaluated parameters of overtraining syndrome from 51 participants, athletes with overtraining syndrome, healthy athletes, and healthy non-physically active controls. We performed overall pairwise comparison for statistically significant differences between the three groups. So they basically just did some observing. So this is an observational study, and observational studies are just for generating hypotheses. Not purely just, but most of the time. So keep all with a grain of salt. And let's see if we have something. Yes, this is very important. So let's look into the conclusions. So, the predominant markers observed in overtraining syndrome were different from those in healthy athletes, but similar to sedentary controls, suggesting that overtraining syndrome is a mix of deconditioning processes independent of excessive training and triggered by additional risk factors. Previously unrecognized, including a lack of sufficient calorie intake, fair sleep quality, and concurrent cognitive effort. The characterization of overtraining syndrome as a combination of multiple decrements in performance in response to conditioning processes in athletes is more representative of an essential clinical aspect of the syndrome, decrease in performance. We found sufficient data to suggest that paradoxical deconditioning syndrome of the athlete is more appropriate and descriptive name for overtraining syndrome than the previous misnomer, which is focused only on excessive training. So this is standard practical knowledge of athletes. So overtraining is not just about training. A better name could, so Cardigiani and Carter, I hope. Yeah, Elias seems yes. Second name. Proposed instead. Ja, von uns. So, paradoxical deconditioning syndrome. So, our first footnote. Risk factors of overtraining syndrome. So why do I keep using this concept? Because overtraining is basically the layman's term for this phenomenon. Overtraining could be, there could be many different names. But it's basically the name everybody uses. And I don't think that one should overly mingle with common language. So all this artificial language twisting is not very productive because over time it will naturally shift. So, for example, I used or I asked myself, how do I call structure notes in English? And there were several candidates, and I asked myself, is structure Zettel the better term or structure note? And the I don't know, I don't remember if it was overwhelming, the overwhelming majority, or or if it was just a tiny majority, but the vote went for structure Zettels. And then everybody basically went on and used structure notes because I think in English it's more natural to say structure notes. So I don't call even the Zettels in the Zettelkasten Zettels, but just notes. Because it's more natural. So, wait a minute, I control for. Okay, we are. Oh, six concurrent viewers. Okay, perhaps some more viewers than expected due to some issues with the herald of the stream, but also mine because I needed to shift a bit the appointment. So, risk factors of overtraining. Let's just copy or find them in this model. Wow, we got this picture. So perhaps we can download it. No. Drag image to reposition. Double click to even. It's an image viewer. Is it big enough? Open with preview. Oh, I hope I have. So we do it like this. Oh, now it's in downloads, so perhaps, yeah, I need to change. So I copied it in here, but it's a little bit too small, so we will look up the individual factors. So do we have something that we can just straight out copy? Perhaps in the results. No, yes. Table 4, parameter mask, classified, yeah, results, athletes, so no. There is no. There's no. No clean list. But there should be a clean list. So this is not so well thought out. So what they basically should have done in the study is to make this not only a picture, but have some text model of it. So you can just copy and paste. So these are risk factors. So how is the model? How is the model we are using here? We have risk factors and in two categories: classical or classic risk factors and novel risk factors. So this is basically the training side. And this was already known, and there are other risk factors that suggest that overtraining is not just about excessive training, but also about concurrent stress factors, the bottom two, or concurrent lack of regenerative measures in the life. So, concept. Overtraining is not just about training. It seems to be more likely a disbalance between anabolic and catabolic factors on the catabolic training, bodily stress and cognitive stress. Physical stress is more appropriate. So anabolic I'm sometimes a bit clumsy with the keyboard. So this is nutrition. Sleep. So cognitive stress is working, studying, concurrent stressful professional, social or environment, family environment. So social stress, social stress. So, and now we will place the footnote in here, and there are There are some reasons for that. This looked kind of messy, but imagine if we would study more and more on this topic and other factors come into play, then we can distinguish from where we would have those factors. So imagine I have one other paper and it's only about physical stress. Then I wouldn't have the ability to distinguish who proposed which factor. So perhaps another a more appropriate example would be imagine meditative practices would show an increased tolerance for training. I would have like I have it like this: sleep, comma, and meditation. If I would put the footnote or the reference up here or just here, I couldn't distinguish where I got the factors from. And I don't know if it's important in the future, but I know that when I decide that something is not important in the future, it always bites me in the ass. So I do it like this. So risk factors. So independent. Okay, where is is it in top? Yes. Correlation. Correlation with worse sleep. Only one search for correlation. So, okay, I don't want to bore you with me trying to manage finding. A total of 5 of the 50 excluded parameters were answered. Okay, blah, blah. Okay, this. Is the one I need. This is the central sentence of this study. So let's. So we just so this is how scientists, by the way, get mistreated. What we did is halfway to a dishonest quote, because if you see it in before, this is reinforces this theory that overtraining syndrome, blah blah blah. This is quite another sentence than this sentence. And we could decide if we want this for ourselves and if we just process it for ourselves. It doesn't matter. But the quote, makes the statement more strong than the scientists made. They rather said, the results of our study suggests that overtraining syndrome rises from a combination of risk factors and not just excessive training alone. So this is a much stronger statement than the before. And if this statement in isolation would be found in the researchers would get kind of would make their colleagues angry because not angry, but it's not how scientists speak. They don't overstretch or overburden their evidence. So this is our risk factors. Mean our work. Okay, we just copy it out there. So the issue with copying it is that it should be a direct quote, but on the other hand, these are so basic sentences that to me it's okay to don't have like quotation marks or something like that to suggest that non-related factors to over. I hope you get my point. So we have these risk factors. Did we miss reinforces in summary? Where are the other factors? So why is here unrefreshing sleep? Paradoxical, blah, blah, blah. Sleep, sleep, sleep quality, sleep. Sleep, sleep, sleep. Decreased sleep quality, self-report compared to previous sleep quality, yes. But why is it not mentioned in any measurement? I don't see any. Where are the methods? Methods, methods, methods. Okay, this is kind of sketchy. Or perhaps it's in another study and they measured it in another study. So because, wait, where is it in the footnotes? So you see here the EROS profile. So it's another study of the, it's another paper that measures perhaps the same thing, just in another study. Yeah, you see there are some different papers on the EROS. So if I would process this myself or for myself, I probably would read those four studies to cross-reference and see what they uh and see what they wrote there. So this is, for example, a publicly available study. Let's see what the conclusion is. Okay. Measurements. 51 subjects, so we see if it was. Yeah, it's just the ERO study. So they basically made a big observational study and then milked the observational results. Let's see if they have some pictures in here, because cortisol, sedentary healthy athletes. Ah, yes. Oh, that's kind of interesting. So healthy athletes have a higher cortisol response to insulin tolerance tests. That's very interesting. So that kind of throws a bit the post-workout nutrition thing out of the window. This is for me personally more important. Yeah, ACTH increase, that's yeah. Saliva, cortisol rhythm, 30 minutes cortisol, so this paints a different picture, because in the last study, as you remember, they didn't include the cortisol rhythm. So let's see here, where did we problem social patterns, number, how sad do you feel, it was basically on the top, after glycemia, the non-substantiated marker, reason to be excluded from the joint analysis. So basal difference between here. See that? Difference between 8 and 16 o'clock of cortisol. And here we have it. Morning cortisol and afternoon cortisol. This is 30 minutes after awakening. Yeah. So what we see here, which is basically concept risk factors, how did they call it here? Intensity stressors, yeah, preclinical alterations, risk factors, symptoms changed, cortisol rhythm, but how did they, you see, I don't remember everything. Where is it? Give it to me. Duration of night sleep, self-reported ratios, psychological patterns, biochemical. No. Cortisol. Okay, then don't find it, then I just go with here. Salivary. Changed cortisol rhythm. Normally I would call it like the circadian rhythm changed. Cortisol, and then I would use this. Oh, is it statistically significant? I don't see. Okay, perhaps we just shortcut it by the conclusion. Yeah, this is normal, but I can tell you from my experience. Yeah. No. Blunted cortisol. Spike 30 minutes after awakening. So to explain it to you, where is it? No. Cortisol is a stress hormone, and it's kind of a slow reacting stress hormone. So you have adrenaline and noradrenaline, and those are excreted if you have acute stress. So imagine I surprise you from behind and I kick you in the ass, then you would get a great spike in adrenaline and also noradrenaline. Afterwards, if I would continue to harass you, the cortisol would be also been spiking. So it's a slow stress hormone. So you can say it. And cortisol also plays an important role in your feeling of being awake. So what we can see here, I think those athletes could, or this profile does not suggest that cortisol is here affecting the sleep, but the overtrained athletes had basically no true spike in cortisol. So this is after awakening, and then they feel 30 minutes after they woke up, they feel the same. And this explains why overtraining athletes feel that their sleep is not good, because they don't wake up refreshed. The feeling of being refreshed comes from this. You wake up and then you are ready to go. And so you don't actually feel that your energy stores mentally and physically are full and you're ready to go, but you feel the stress hormones mobilizing the energy. And it would be an interesting question why the cortisol is blunted, but this is I can tell you this from experience. So this is basically the effect of either overtraining or chronic stress. I hope I Remember it. Yeah, we'll do it later. Oh no, I do it now. The issue is if I... So look, if I import it into my my BibTeX file, then I didn't have processed it in... okay, I need to do it later and I will process this story also. Okay. Hope I don't slur too much. Lazy Greasy, what will we be talking today? So I processed a bit of a study, and you see here the result of the note. The dark mode is a bit annoying because the contrasts are not good enough. Perhaps I make a presentation mode for the dark because I don't want to have all this shiny, the shiny things in my face. Oh no, this is wrong. So we could basically also no. It seems that this is the complete model. So they pulled in the results of all the other studies. So clinical surveillance, worsened mood states. Okay. So this is the model and I don't think I can process right now. So how does overtraining basically happens? You have those factors: low protein intake, low carbohydrate intake, and so on and so forth. This leads to chronic adaptions and therefore and further chronic maladaptions. So this is basically what happens. These are the causal factors. So because your glycogen stores are chronically depleted, your body will react. Because your energy and energy storage saving modes are activated, your body will adapt further. Excessive non-repaired oxidative stress means that you have basically oxidative stress. Increased inflammatory cytokines, so inflammation or chronic inflammation, and your immune system is impaired. This goes into this state. So we have here reduced metabolic state, energy saving mechanisms, and this would be relatively flattened hypothalamic responses. That means that your body won't react with hormones so intensively, and this would be the result of oxidative stress, of these three factors, for example. And then when you take this as the sum, the result will be those kind of factors. So basically, how does overtraining functions? Overtraining functions or works like this concept and model. Risk factors, maladaptions, Overtraining Syndrome. Example. Oh no, I don't give an example. Okay, I think that will be it for today. A bit slower than expected. But you had nothing to say in the chat, but you see I'm just working on a note, and this is our process it. I didn't include so much critical thinking at the moment, so I was just more or less collecting, and I think this paper doesn't give me the chance to practice so much critical thinking, because what they basically did, they measured a bunch of factors and then basically said, okay, this is connected to overtraining syndrome and this is not, and then they come up with this model. And the model is kind of interesting. So these preclinical alterations could be further used. But on the other side, and I can give you an anecdotal example, all those things are kind of little crumbs of a big mosaic picture, because carbohydrate intake should be taken, for example, with a grain of salt. I had a training experiment that went for a couple of years, and I ate a very low, sometimes zero carbohydrate diet. And my training regimen was that I trained sometimes up to 6 to 8 hours a day, and it was quite intense. And I combined it with intermittent fasting and so on and so forth. But I didn't go into the state of overtraining. I kind of went there and then I backed off. So my training regimen was 2 to 4 training sessions per day. And I trained with all kinds of crazy stuff. So interval training with a gas mask on to limit my breathing capacity, and like 4-hour martial arts sessions. And sometimes in the morning I swam, and then in the or early in the morning I swam. Then in the during the morning I did strength training. In the noon I did wrestling, and in the evening additional endurance training, and I basically survived it. But I ate really a buttload of protein, and my fat intake was insanely high. I drank 200 milliliters of whipped cream to every meal. So basically, I think on many days on those phases, I drank 1 liter of whipped cream, and I was in very great shape. I could show you a photo from back then, but it wouldn't be appropriate. But I was very, very lean, and the conclusion of my experiment, for me at least, was in case of calorie intake, less protein intake. And it worked. So a very low carbohydrate diet can happen. So how? Okay, it's just risk factor. So it's not like a causal mechanism that they're stating here. Yeah, but this model is basically just an inspiration to develop one own model. And the basic model is you have those kind of factors and those kind of factors. So you have catabolic factors and anabolic factors, and you can balance high stress out with anabolic factors. And another example would be having high cognitive stress, but at the same time doing specific kind of meditations and walking a lot in the forest and having meaning techniques. I call it meaning techniques. So you create meaning for the things you do. It's kind of complicated to explain, but perhaps someday in the future, in some future live stream. And that will greatly, greatly increase your capacity to endure cognitive stress. So the basic model of overtraining is an imbalance problem. Everything has, of course, its boundaries. You can't just out-eat any amount of training, but you see it. It's basically practical knowledge in many sport fields that if you eat a buttload of food, you can train a lot more and get a lot of more adaptation. So two examples would be, or the first example would be strongman training. So the strongmen are eating like really insane numbers. So 12,000 calories a day is kind of normal for some of them. And so 8 to 12,000 calories a day is like a normal strongman diet. And the reason is, or their calorie intake is so high because their training is kind of different than other strength athletes. They couldn't get away with way less calories. And another example is Matt Fraser, arguably the fittest man according to the CrossFit doctrine of, or the fittest man in history according to the CrossFit doctrine, made it a point to eat during the CrossFit games, to really overeat, to basically balance out the stress of the CrossFit games. And it worked. And he said, or he said that it was a major factor in him being able to recover during the workouts. So I think that's it for today. I'm still trying to figure out how to attack this properly. So of course I would be much faster if I wouldn't need to like comment everything and basically focus myself on this kind of demanding task to really understand what the researchers are doing here. Perhaps I will someday in the future process something that doesn't need any like cross-referencing, and because I don't feel comfortable processing the studies, at least without reading those four other papers and doing so more cross references and or cross check more studies. So this is kind of sloppy work for demonstration how you can derive some information and build up your Zettelkasten from a study, but I think to demonstrate really clean scientific work, I would need to like pre-record it and pretend. Oh, hi, Elkan. I was going to shut the stream down, but here you are. But I think it's a bit late. I think you should go to sleep. It's better. It's better to sleep healthy instead of trying to watch this live. But still glad that you are here. So about to sleep, leaving. Ah, okay. Leaving a message here and watch the replay. I don't really get the idea behind U1 and U2 notes, but perhaps no, there is nothing to get. It's just an old habit I'm keeping. I never ever had something practical by distinguishing the different levels of structure notes. In my own Zettelkasten, I don't link my U2 equivalent notes together, so I think I'm missing out on something here. I don't think so. The linking happens quite naturally, perhaps I even find... Ah, you see it in here. So, look. Now I'm in the movement department and you see it's kind of hierarchical at this moment. In some time in the future, we could link those notes together. Yeah, we need more notes. We just need more notes in here to make the Zettelkasten more dynamic, to give me more associations and make it more creative.